Jennifer Rowe from the library, who's going to be giving us a little tutorial on how to use Foundation resources and research. Thank you very much for joining us
and for showing us
through all of this. So we can just jump in.
Okay, thank you. And I'd like to also introduce my colleague who I brought. She's just kind of observing here today, but she's the Yvonne Dooley, she's the business librarian. So you're the subject librarian for the College of Business and the Department of Economics, is that right? Okay. So you guys
will be able to answer lots of questions.
Yeah, so maybe she might be able to answer questions I can.
So
I'm Jennifer Rowe. I'm the subject librarian. I'm social sciences librarian. So I'm the subject librarian for all of the departments in the College of Health and Public Service and the Department of Anthropology, and I coordinate our library. The reason I'm here is because I coordinate our library's funding resources, so the Foundation Center resources that I'm going to demonstrate for you. I work in the Eagle Commons Library, and as I guess you guys already have, because Naomi was here, you probably already have a little bit more of an idea of how the Foundation Center resources work. So they're only available inside the Eagle Commons Library on the premises, on our desktop computers. And the reason for that is that that particular vendor, the Foundation Center, doesn't really have an access model where they allow remote access there. The database access is still IP authenticated. And so we could pay exponentially more to expand our access to all the buildings on campus, but it still wouldn't allow for people to access those resources remotely or to log in off campus. So I apologize for that. It's not the most convenient setup, but that's what we're working with right now. It is a really worthwhile tool to use, though, and it sounds like a few of you have already explored it. So I will just show you how to access the Foundation Center database. That's actually called Foundation Directory Online. I'll show you how to access that and how to do some searches. And they just sort of revamped the search interface. So I think when I talked to you, Juliana, it was totally different than it is now. So I don't know if you've seen the updated version. But it's a little easier to use. That's good news because it's more intuitive to use. So in order to access the Foundation Directory online, you'll start at the UNT Libraries homepage, which is library.unt.edu, again on any of the desktop computers in the Eagle Commons Library. And you'll go to the Databases tab. And the simplest thing to do is just do a search for, actually, you just put in the word foundation and do a search. And this is a good place for me to talk about some of the other resources that they provide. So this will just take you to a listing of all of these three things. So it's just a little redundant. But so the Foundation Directory Online is the resource that we're going to look at today. And it is a great tool for nonprofits to find grant opportunities from foundations, public charities, corporate giving programs and corporate foundations, and they've recently added some government funders, some of the big national, some of the big federal grant funders to the database. So that's the Foundation Directory Online. There are over 140,000 funder profiles, so it's a really powerful tool. If you've tried just searching Google for funding for nonprofit organizations, it's a much easier way to find those opportunities and kind of narrow down your search by subject area, by geography. So it's a very powerful tool for that. The Foundation Grants to Individuals Online is similar to the Foundation Directory Online, but as the name implies, it contains only profiles for those funders who directly fund individuals, which is not as large of a pool of funders, because most foundation and funders restrict their giving to only organizations, and usually organizations with a 501c3 status. So there aren't as many, it's not as robust of a tool, the Foundation Grants to Individuals Online. The types of grant opportunities that you would find in there. If there's some overlap with PIVOT, you'll find research type grant opportunities, you know, grant funding opportunities for artistic projects or scholarships for education, for travel, that kind of thing. And then the foundation maps is a tool that takes information from the foundation directory online and sort of overlays it on Google Maps so you can visualize like patterns of giving and who's giving to whom in a specific geographic area. So we'll look at the foundation directory online. I'm just gonna click through, and you have to click a couple times to get to it. And as long as you're on one of our desktop computers in the ECL, this will already be logged in, but I have a temporary login for demonstration today. Yeah, they at least allow me to take the access off.
Yeah, because otherwise how can you show it,
right? Right, exactly. If you're in the ECL when you access this, yeah, you obviously skip the login step, and when you click through to open the database, it'll be on the next screen. It'll be on this screen. And so you've already tried it. You searched just the other day.
You can save the password if you want.
I have to promise, like, my firstborn to them that I won't give out the password. So, but Sycamore Mall isn't that far away, so you don't have to walk very far from here to come over and search. So what's new about this, for those of you who may have looked at the foundation directory online before, is that before you had like a bunch of indexes that you had to click on an index for each search field and select an index term, and it was kind of complicated and difficult to get used to. And so what they've done, I think, is really cool. So they have like a Google type search function right up at the top, and you can just plug in. So for you guys, what would be a good search for somebody, or for
if you can put music entrepreneurship?
Okay, we'll just try that. Hopefully I've spelled that correctly. And then we could say in Texas, and I think if we narrow, let's try actually just as an example, let's just show it like in Denton, Texas. I just want to see what will happen if we do this. Because I think that's a lot of, like, that's what they're saying we should do. We should just put in our geographic area, our subject term in here, and search, and the database will do the rest for us. And let's see how that works.
Finding funders. Wow.
Yeah. So, okay. I was expecting it to find zero. Because I did a search yesterday for something in Denton, Texas, and it brought back zero, and I was going to show you how to fix that. But, okay. So it seems to have done a better job. So we got 9 grant makers, 28 grants, 8 recipients. And then it also brings up, it will allow you to access the 990 forms that nonprofits submit annually to the IRS, and they have a ton of information in them about, you know, the organization's investments, what they pay their staff, who they're giving grants to, for what amounts, for what projects. So this doesn't seem like a really high number. So what I'm going to do right away, and if we had done a search and gotten zero results, I would have gone to the advanced search and filters here. So at any point, you can control your search a little bit more.
Can you, before you leave that page, can you send us this right now? Like, since you have it, can you send us, like, save this so we can look into it later, like the names of these organizations?
So at any point, you can export all of these. So we have 9 grant makers right here. And so you're going to want to look through them a little bit more just to make sure they are actually all aligned with your...
For you to look through them, you have to go to their own websites, or do you see more information on the foundation website?
We'll click through. So let's just try
one. Let's do the Denton, the Newman Foundation down there. Yeah.
Oh! I've never seen that one before. Okay, so let's just look at the Newman Foundation, for example. So if you click on the name, And so just before I click through on anything, I'll show you. So here's the grant makers at the top. The grant, so it, again, it'll let you click through to either the grant maker or the recipient. And it says the grant amount, the area. And then again, we have a list down here of recipients. So, and then 990s.
Of the recipients?
Yeah, or the funders. It could be a mix of both, actually, for the 990s. But you can access at 990s for any of these that you want to just by clicking through to their profile. So, like, let's look at the Newman Foundation. And all of the, or a lot of the information that's in this database is pulled from those 990 forms. Mm-hmm. There are a handful of foundations that I think the Foundation Center contacts directly. And has a relationship with, and they're given the information directly, but most of the information they sift through the 990 forms to populate this database. So the Newman Foundation, it just gives you at a glance information here at the top, which is pretty cool because you can see, it just visualizes what they're funding the most. So higher education is by far what they're giving the most money to. Performing arts, it doesn't look like they're giving to at all. And then on the map, you can see it just the highlighted states or states that they've given to. So definitely giving to Texas, and then the amounts of the grants. So it looks like most of the grants that they're giving are really small.
And then
pretty small, under 5,000.
Each grant was more detailed. That's awesome.
Yeah. Wow. So then you can see the recipients for this particular funder. So they go into the Denton Festival Foundation. And then funding interests, population groups that they tend to fund.
So there's a lot of information you can get right off this database without having to go into the actual website of each organization.
Yeah, and some of the organizations, a lot of foundations won't have a website. Mm-hmm. So this may be your best source for information. Some of them, if they have a website, obviously go to the website to try to make get the most up-to-date information from their website, especially regarding the application information or that kind of thing, deadlines and that kind of thing. Because unlike Pivot, like you guys saw Pivot last week, so you know Pivot shows you right in your search results when the deadline is. And this, they don't emphasize the deadlines because a lot of these funders will fund the same, fund programs. They'll have the same grant program annually, and so they might have a rolling deadline, which will be every June or every December, or maybe four times a year, but it's for most of them, it's gonna be the same year after year. And so it just requires you to kind of go, sometimes they'll have the deadline listed here in the application. No, so this one doesn't have really anything listed in the application information section. Sometimes they'll have a deadline listed in a preferred initial contact method listed here. Like some of the foundations that you'll see may prefer for you to send a letter of intent. Some may prefer a full proposal. Others will have some sort of online application form. It just depends. And so if it's not listed here, try to go out to their website if you've got a question.
I was going
to
ask, so with this one, it says unsolicited requests for funds are not accepted. So is there, I've seen that on a lot of them. Is there a way you have to just have a connection or be invited to?
So that helps. If you have some sort of connection, that's a huge help. And what can help you determine if you have a connection is sometimes there will be information down here about their governing body, about their trustees or their staff. So you can, these people are conceivably in the local area they're in or around Denton. You maybe could send this profile to yourself and see, do you in your group, in your circle of acquaintances, do you know anybody who might know these people?
Oh, wow.
So that's one way. Definitely knowing somebody helps. But if that's not always going to be the case, you won't always know somebody at that particular foundation. And a lot of them will say no unsolicited applications accepted.
Wow.
And that, I don't think that you should let that discourage you, because I think something like 60% or more of these funders that are in here will say that. And the reason, usually the reason for that is that they don't have the capacity to just accept applications from everywhere all the time. So they prefer to sort of, limit the amount of applications and inquiries that they're receiving. So the best thing that you can do if you see unsolicited requests for funds not accepted is to kind of try to do your homework, try to do a little bit of research to figure out what types, what the mission of this funder is and what types of things maybe they've funded in the past or that they say they will fund. And then when you've gleaned as much information as you can, maybe reach out to somebody at that. If it still seems like a good match after you've done your research, to figure out what this organization's mission is, then reach out to somebody. And sometimes all it takes is a phone call or an email or a letter, and then they will invite you to apply. Oh. So they just want to have one barrier. A lot of them just want to have some sort of barrier between them and just a barrage of applications. So all it takes is just reaching out and saying, here's what my group is doing. And based on your mission statement that's online, I thought that we might be a good match to apply for funding. And what do you think? And they'll either say yes or no.
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
That's a wonderful recommendation. Because if you say 60% of these are...
I think I don't know the exact, but it's a lot.
It's a majority. Big percentage, yeah, majority. Then that can be quite discouraging for a student who just goes to, walks all the way to Eagle Commons Library, sits there and tries to research and then finds that they don't have the possibility. So we need to make sure they see this video. Because that should be you should have a little pop-up on the system that says, don't get discouraged.
Yeah.
Reach out anyway.
Yeah.
Because that's true. That's true. That's a great suggestion. And something as simple as a letter.
Yeah.
With just an introduction, as you say, this is who we are, we're very interested, and I think we would be a wonderful fit. Ooh, like that may be all it takes. You're right. It's not that difficult. But no one would think of that if you see this.
Right.
You see that it says no unsolicited applications.
It sounds very daunting.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I can't apply for that.
Yeah. It's immediately a discarding factor. So thank you for that.
Yeah, and it might be that they have already have established relationships with those organizations that they want to fund, and they're not really looking to expand the group of organizations that they fund. But if somebody comes along that is doing something that's very well aligned with their mission, then they might rethink that. Mm-hmm. So you have to kind of make them aware of what you're doing and how sort of sell your program, sell yourself, and let them know how that's aligned with their mission.
So you said there's about 140,000 foundations there?
Funder profiles in here.
Wow.
So that's, most of them are United States organizations. There are a few international ones. There are a handful of federal government funders, but the vast majority are foundations and public charities. Either corporate foundations or family foundations or operating foundations. So, so you asked about emailing or saving the profiles. So from this profile view that we have right here, well, first of all, I wanted to show you how to, so usually whenever, I can't remember now because they've just changed the interface, it's either at the bottom in this contact information section, or it's right up at the top. But whenever the funder does have a website, usually there will be a link to a URL to their website.
So this one doesn't?
It doesn't look like this one does. So they may not have a website. Some of the funders, if they're smaller or new, they may not have a website. And so did it have a contact person? No. So it has an address. This one you could send a letter to. Mm-hmm. They don't even have an email.
Wow.
A lot of them will have an email address, at least, or the name of a person and a phone number of a person that you can contact for grant inquiries. But this one doesn't. So this one might be a matter of sending a letter, or if you know any of these people, kind of contacting one of them. to ask. You may be able, it's possible you may be able to get more information from the 990s, like a name of a staff member, or this one might not even have a skinny staff. Like some foundations may be so small that it might just be their board and one person or two people, so yeah. And then, okay, so what I was gonna show you is you can do a couple of different things to sort of save this profile. So from inside the profile page, you can email. This is what I recommend. So just, you know, we can put in music and the geographic location or whatever, and that's the easy part, because now we have a list of funders, but then the hard part is kind of going into each one and investigating to see how well that funder actually aligns with, because they may say, like some of them may be, let me see, this one's in Kansas City, so. It may, you know, every once in a while you'll see one that'll say.
But that one works with everyone, yeah. But they're based in Kansas. Yeah, that's one of the ones we've seen, right, Jen, the common?
So some of them may be like, you know, limitations to, you know, like if you search Texas as a geographic area, you might get some funders that come up in your list that specify, you know, we only give in Amarillo, Texas, or in Houston, and not any of the rest of the state.
Yeah,
so it requires like further investigations to sort of weed out those ones that don't fit for some reason. And you guys have already seen this one, for example?
Yeah.
Okay. Again,
But this is really great, even this just simple breakdown of the, like, if you go to their website, you can't see all of this yet too.
Right. And if you go to the 990s,
breaks it down very easily to understand.
Yeah, and if you go to the 990s, you would literally have to go through 5 years of 990s.
Right.
And it'd be really tedious to look at. But this just is a really nice graphic.
It's kind of like GuideStar, you know, GuideStar, but for a different purpose. But it kind of does the same thing. It gathers information, it creates all these tables and things, and it's very easy to see. Wow, I wish this was more accessible.
I know, you know, I hope in the coming, like in the near future, that they'll have a model for.
Oh, look, they gave already to UND.
Yeah. Oh, look, and entrepreneurship was the primary subject. So, do you want to look at?
Yes, please.
So, this was 2004.
No, you can go to the bottom one. That one looks more interesting.
Okay. So, there's the 35.
I'll take the second one.
So let's see what this is all about. So it was to the University of North Texas Murphy Enterprise Center.
That's me.
That's him, Sean Murphy.
I've been on that for a while.
It was a cash grant for internships. And that's all we know about that. To encourage organizations, so the description, to encourage organizations to build or expand internships which expose students to entrepreneurship and both profit, for-profit and not-for-profit.
I call this a home run.
Yeah, so this is pretty...
We need to get this for our program.
Absolutely, yep. So, yeah, if you haven't saved the profile for the...
But the profile doesn't say that, you know? Like, we want to know that they already funded UNT twice, right? Now we know.
Yeah, you can and kind of go into... Because
this is like more than 10 years ago. This was a long time ago.
Yeah.
2003, 2004.
And
it's like orange. That's when it tells you who is funded, right?
Yeah, the recipients show up in orange. Yeah. And it's kind of color-coded, so you'll get used to that as you play with the database. With the funders were purple, I think. The recipients are orange.
Just for time-saving purposes, can you save these two?
So I can email
this one
to you.
Yeah.
I already saved the coffin one.
Yeah. You saved it for
coffin? I saved one you can download to our drive. I don't know if I had like the specific gifts.
If we can save this so that this is showing us everything in detail.
Yeah, so one of the things that is, okay, let me just really quickly, and then you guys can see exactly.
Yeah.
So it's Fabiana...
Clauri. C-L-A-U-R-E.
Oops.
And UND.edu. Thank you.
Oops. My fingers are on the wrong keys. And if you're emailing to yourself, obviously you can just type your own email address in both
right.
fields.
And then can you send us a PDF one more of the one for the actual grants that they gave? Yeah.
For this?
Yeah, those two.
Let's see.
We can just email those.
Yep.
So we can see those details.
Excellent. Using the back button, but it's usually best to use the breadcrumbs there. So that, which
I guess. Yeah,
both. I emailed you the 35, yeah. right? Mm-hmm. So then.
We can do that one too.
Yeah.
Okay. This is great. Because it breaks it down so easy to understand.
Yeah.
See what entities are getting how much money.
So they're doing a class project for the end of the semester where they need to find funding opportunities for the Louisville Lake Symphony.
Okay.
They're doing a consulting project for them, like a real consulting project. So this is why this is very helpful, because better than just Googling, right?
Right.
They can just get lost in the maze there.
Exactly.
They go here, they put, what was the type of search that you did?
I just did music.
Music.
And then I went to the orange results where you can see who gets the money, and they were all symphonies.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really, really interesting. So, okay, so here, this is kind of the advanced search, and it shows us what, so when I just typed in, you know, music entrepreneurship, Denton, Texas, it filled in these fields for us, the geographic focus and the subject area, and I can adjust and change this. But what I wanted to point out is that the grant makers that it brings up, these two fields are kind of important here. It arranges it by relevance according to these two fields. So this amount funded is actually the amount funded based on my search criteria. So Denton, based on Denton, Texas, and music and entrepreneurship. So all of the funders that are appearing here, the ones that are at the top have actually funded music or entrepreneurship related things in Denton, Texas for this amount, 300,000, and 10 grants. So these numbers are specific to my search terms, not just like in general, like this is their total giving that they've given to everybody.
Can we take a peek at what they did there in the Wells Fargo?
Yeah.
So if you can see is there by any chance, because that seems to be a big donor.
Yeah, and then you kind of are touching on something else really important, that like to look at the recipients is really smart too, because
yep,
you can see what recipients may be similar to you that are getting grants and who they're getting funded by, and then
the
kind of follow that trail. Yeah.
That's what you were saying, that there's the same type of people.
Yeah.
Renew.
So this might mean Festival Foundation is a little bit different, but they might still fund, this funder might still fund symphonies.
Can we go to the second page?
Oh, yeah. Let's see if they're all the same or.
Wow, they got lucky.
They got a lot of money from, well, is this one Wells Fargo?
I think that's for the Jazz Festival. Mm-hmm.
The Denton Arts and Jazz Festival?
Yeah. They're like a big sponsor of that.
You can learn so much though about this.
Yeah.
It's so helpful.
And then you can just click to expand these. I wish they would just be automatically kind of expanded, but. And it's interesting because they're funding, we see that they're funding the Festival Foundation year after year, but there's nothing in this description of their programs to indicate that they would fund that type of thing. So that's why it's really cool to actually look, to use this database to look at what, you know, the funder may say we'd like to fund this, this, and this, but then when you actually look at what they're spending their money on, it may be different.
Wow.
And so you may get a clue that, well, if I ask this funder for funding, you know, it might not hurt to ask Because it does look like they're already funding people who are doing similar things.
And it's like everything, right? You build a relationship with your funder. The funder builds a relationship with the organization. And it can go on for decades. I mean, this, how many years has the Festival Foundation been getting money from this organization?
Right. And it does depend. Some of them, like this one, obviously Wells Fargo will fund the same provide funds for the same programs year after year. And some of them will have limitations, like maybe because they're smaller and they don't have that many, like Wells Fargo is well funded. The profits come, or the funding for that foundation comes, you know, from the profits from the company. But if it's like a family foundation, they may, a lot of them will say, you know, we only fund an organization for 1 year, or some of them for 2 years. It may be, there may be a limit to that. So it just depends on the funder. But you're right. But developing a relationship certainly doesn't hurt anything.
And then once you go through the process of obtaining one of these, you know, grants, then you learn about it and you can find easier ways to use for other, you know, other organizations and find other potential funders. Because it's the first time that it's the hardest to kind of go through all of this and figure out how to use this database, how to find information. How to even approach these organizations if they say they don't want, you know, any unsolicited applications.
Yeah.
And then you kind of get into the you know, habit of doing this. What is that who's who? I see that in all the listings. What do they
so that
at?
Is, it's kind of lets you jump down to this section which lists the officers and directors, trustees. Sometimes, like for Wells Fargo, because it is a bigger organization, they even have some staff members listed. And then they have links to these people's LinkedIn. So if you're on LinkedIn, you could connect conceivably on LinkedIn with these people.
Oh, wow. So they kind of know that you need to create these relationships because many of them, if you scroll to the top, what does it say there? I found that interesting.
Oh, see who can introduce you to someone. Yeah. So. So, you know, they're just trying to facilitate.
It's already broken into the, filtered into the system there. They know how it works. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's what everyone's doing. They're trying to find someone to.
It's kind of like you said, it's relationship building. Yeah. Who you know and how you can.
So they already have that into the database.
Yeah.
Let's connect you with these people.
Yeah, like I said, the Foundation Center has just overhauled this and they've really tried to add a lot of features that
their LinkedIn profiles and everything.
Yeah, really.
Which LinkedIn already tells you if you know anyone who knows this person.
Yeah.
Right? LinkedIn has that system that says you know this and this, who knows this and that. So, wow.
Yeah. And then the giving limitations. So I like to look at this because this is a really, usually a really enlightening section. If there are any limitations listed in here, it'll just basically tell you who's excluded. And a lot of what you'll see here in the limitations is no support for religious organizations, and sometimes it's no support for religious organizations that are not of direct benefit to the entire community. A lot of foundations won't give to lobbying or fraternal organizations. And then you'll frequently see no grants to individuals because, right, like I said, a lot of the foundations will only give to organizations. Nonprofit organizations, not directly to individuals.
Yeah, Naomi mentioned that as well because they have a system of accountability and control that an individual may or may not have. So they kind of want to know that there's already an infrastructure set up to control the allocation of the funds. That makes sense, especially if it's a lot of money.